Before you slice off that keiki, stop. One wrong cut could stunt your mother plant and its baby. Let us show you the exact moment and method to remove those keikis to ensure you have a thriving new orchid every time. Today we'll dive into the most exciting part of orchid care, taking a thriving orchid and turning it into two or many. But timing is everything, and how you remove the keiki can be the difference between getting a thriving new orchid, a strong independent plant, or a struggling little seedling. By the end of this video, you'll know exactly when to take off your keikis, where to cut it, how to pot them, and that crucial aftercare to help it root faster so that you can get your full-grown plant sooner. No guesswork, no losses, just predictable success. Here at The Nature Company, we try and demystify the science behind orchid care so you're not left frustrated and confused. These steps I'll show you, you can use on any orchid, whether it's a phalaenopsis or, for instance, a dendrobium that I'm working with today, but the methods and the timing and what you need to look out for are all going to be the same. I'm going to use this failed experiment to show you because it's got lots of keikis to work with, and we'll go through some different techniques. This I'll explain to you in another video. It's several different types of dendrobiums that we put in a single basket to try and get color all year round at different or at different times of year. But I'll do a whole video on this because it was actually quite an interesting experiment. We can see with this dendrobium, we have lots of keikis, all different sizes all over the show. If you're dealing with a phalaenopsis, you'll probably only have possibly one, if you're lucky, two keikis on the end of those flower spikes. And then sometimes you'll have little offshoots coming from the base, but that's a slightly different topic. We have covered that in a previous video. You can check that video. We'll drop a link to it in the description box down below. But for those keikis that are on those flower spikes, and for these keikis that happen on the dendrobiums like this on their canes, basically the method you're going to be using is exactly the same. And when is the best timing for removal of these keikis? The best timing is generally in spring. That's not to say that spring is always going to be the perfect time for it. Sometimes as you head into summer is also going to be okay, or probably better for some of them. But you're going to have to be looking at the keiki itself and see what point of maturity it is at, because that's going to play a more important part. Of course, if you do have cold winters and that's not the sort of timing that you want to be using to repot your keikis, unless you have no other choice. But by repotting them in their growing season, you're going to have much better success. You're not setting back your plant any, and your mother plant is not going to be affected either. By repotting at that wrong time of year, sometimes they can take a lot longer to root, to settle down and become acclimatized to where they are. Let's start off with the right timing for the removal of those keikis. It's an important factor, and it helps with the initial growth of your plant. That cutting and removing of those keikis is also very important, because not only can you damage the mother plant, but you can also set those keikis back and slow their development. So the timing is going to be important in those initial stages to ensure that you get that initial growth and adaption of the plant to the media and the pot that it's in, to help it set quickly and then allow it to grow properly. This means we want to repot these keikis or remove these keikis during the growing season. We don't want to do it in the flowering season, because that's when all the plant's energy is going towards flowering and not towards the growth of the plant. The growth of the plant then comes generally afterwards. We also don't want to do it in the dormant season, because then your plant is just sitting around dormant waiting for the temperatures and the environment to become right for it to then start its growth season. You don't really want to do it during these seasons, because for one, the hormone balance inside your plant is all incorrect for what you're wanting to get out of it. You're wanting that growth to be happening, and your plant itself is not in that growth phase, so it doesn't have all those growth hormones coursing around its system, so it's not really going to be growing. By removing those keikis at the wrong point, those babies are not getting the growth signals and hormones from the mother plant at the right time. And It may take a couple of seasons for it to balance out its own system and figure out the schedule for itself. So by removing it at the right point, when all those growth signals and hormones are coursing around it and it started its growth cycle, it then knows to keep growing. Its cycle has already been started, and that just means it's primed to go. And what are we looking for to ensure that the orchid or those keikis are at the right point? Firstly, we want to see those nice green root tips happening on the tips of each of these little roots. We want to see that the roots are starting to grow and extend. Preferably, the longer that green root tip means the stronger growth is happening, means it's the ideal point. We also want to make sure that our roots of the keiki are at least between 1 and 2 centimeters long to ensure that there's enough root volume there to look after that little baby while it's growing. And also the reason that this timing is so important in removing of these keikis is not only that you've got the signals happening in your plant and that root growth happening, it's also that your climate is now ideal for growth. Your humidity levels are up high enough that if you remove it, you're not going to dehydrate your plant too quickly. Also, that there's going to be enough root volume on your plant to be able to absorb that moisture from not only the atmosphere through that humidity, but through the amount of rain or such that you may be getting or your watering. So with the timing of those removal of the keikis, it's important to ensure that, for one, as I said, you've got enough of that root growth and you have a big enough size plant that it can actually start to maintain itself. Also, you're making sure that your climate has become right for it, that you're starting to get higher temperatures and more humidity so that the growth can take place easily. And also you're ensuring that the plant has initiated the growth itself so that it's gone into the growth phase and that those hormones and growth factors are flowing around in it so that it can keep growing. Now, as to removal of these keikis, there's a few little things that you need to look at when removing these keikis so that you know what's going to be best for them. When you're looking at things like your dendrobiums or even your phalaenopsis when it's on that flower spike and you start seeing a dead part below where the keiki is itself, you know that it's not getting any further nutrition from the mother plant itself. So your best bet to do is with your initial cut is to go in and cut right at the base there where that dead part is. So that may give you either a pseudobulb or that flowering stem that may still be green, but at the bottom part it was dead. So the first thing you got to do is cut off that dead part. If it's a pseudobulb like this or a cane, depending on what you're doing with your orchid, whether you are repotting or mounting it, if you're mounting it, then you can leave the cane or that flower spike still attached to your plant because your little keiki is still going to be drawing some moisture and nutrition out of that pseudobulb or even that flower spike off those phalaenopsis. And then by mounting it like this, you're allowing for all that extra energy and resources for your plant to grow better and faster. If you remove all of this, especially if your keikis are small like this, it's going to take a long time for them to recover because they don't have that instant source of food available to them. They have to start producing their own. Their pseudobulbs or leaves may not be big enough for them to have managed to store enough energy to keep growing very well. So it may take a long time for them to survive, especially if mounted. They're going to dry out quickly, even if you are watering frequently. So this just makes it more beneficial to those keikis that you've removed. And it's not damaging your mother plant in any way because you cut it off at a dead point. If you're wanting to repot these now, what you can actually do is, especially if the roots are still quite small and not very much volume, is then you can then put this into a humid environment. You can either use a humidity box or lay them out on sphagnum moss or something, so that you can ensure you get some good root growth happening before you then want to transplant them into any other media or separate them off the pseudobulb. And if you have some decent sized keikis on your plant that you want to remove without having to remove that pseudobulb or that cane or the flower spike, or you want to just remove it off the flower spike, then you can do that quite easily. Often just by gently lifting it up and away from the pseudobulb. First, you've got to make sure all the roots are loose so that they're not holding onto the plant or that cane, so that you can actually twist it. And all you do is lift it back slightly, slowly off and away. And generally, you'll find it will break off quite easily from the pseudobulb or flower spike. And if you see it's holding at any point, then go in with some sharp pointed sanitized secateurs and just do a little clip here at the base now that you've loosened it up. Just so we're not tearing any of that tissue from that bulb. And then we have our little keiki ready to be potted up. So you will find they will generally snap off quite easily, but as I said, just be a little bit careful. For one, you don't want to damage these young tender roots that it has. You don't want to damage the young growth that it's got. It's going to be like a very gentle process. And if you're worried about doing it that way, then the other way you can do it is just by carefully removing those roots again so that you have a small piece of that cane or pseudobulb. Do a cut in the center between two of those nodes, and that will give you a short little piece of pseudobulb or flower spike attached to your plant. You can then go trim that back slightly closer to that node so that when you treat this with a little bit of cinnamon just to dry it off and so it can harden off, and then you can repot it or mount it like that. This is not going to cause too much damage to your mother plant because all you're doing is removing a small piece of the cane. If it's the flower spike, you're not doing any damage at all. And the small piece here will supply the plant with a small amount of energy for a limited period before it dries out and desiccates. So we see removal of those keikis doesn't have to be too traumatic for you or for the plant either. Just remember, any of those open cut wounds that you have on your plant now from any cuts that you've had to make into it, remember, seal them up with a little bit of cinnamon powder just to ensure that you're not going to get any ingress of those bacterial or fungal spores or anything that might be hanging around that want to attack your plant. And now, how do we go about repotting these guys? If we are looking at putting these into pots, what we want to do is get the base part of those roots into the pot. We don't want to get any leftover pieces of the old pseudobulb or any parts of those rhizome deep into the media, because these guys, as you can see, they used to being out here in the open growing wild. And if we suddenly put them into an environment that's going to hold water or moisture for extended periods that they're not used to, they're going to rot. So we want to ensure that we're just getting those roots into the media, and the rest of it, the rhizome and any other parts of the plant, the pseudobulbs, are going to be above the media. This will allow for air movement in and around the pseudobulbs and the rhizome so that it doesn't rot, so that they can still dry out quickly and slowly become accustomed to a more and more moist environment like what you would have in a pot as opposed to being out in the air. What you also may want to do is you may want to use a humidity dome of some sort and use that to keep the humidity in and around your plant for longer so that it doesn't dry out. Because as I said, these guys don't have much left available to them to keep growing. Their pseudobulbs are really small and they need extra moisture in the air so that they can keep that moisture in their plant and they don't dry out. So Humidity domes can be a good idea, especially as you're starting off these new keikis, just to keep those humidity levels up. Also remember not to have a closed humidity dome. You want something that's going to still allow air movement in, and you're still going to have to let it breathe a couple of times during the day, just so that it can keep getting fresh air into it. And these guys, we're really not going to feed for the first month or so. We really want to check that that root growth is really starting to happen well, and that perhaps we have another new shoot coming up, and then we can start to feed. So generally that's going to be between 4 and 6 weeks before we start adding more fertilizer to our plant. Also during that initial stage, we're not going to be watering terribly much. That's why these humidity domes are such a good idea, because it will keep that moisture in the air without you having to add too much moisture into that media. Because like I said, these were growing out in the air on the pseudobulb and open up to all that air. So as soon as we start putting too much moisture in and around them all the time, those roots aren't going to be acclimatized and they can rot quite easily. So if we keep the amount of wetness to a minimum while still allowing that moisture through the humidity, we can keep those roots alive long enough for them to acclimatize and keep growing in that media. If you get your keiki off early enough, as I said, as long as you have at least 1 or 2 centimeters of roots and not long roots like that, then it can actually be even more beneficial, because then you're not actually putting any of those roots deep into your media. You're just putting them on top of your media and using a stake or something to keep your plant upright. And then the roots can then grow into the media and become immediately acclimatized to the area that they are growing into. And the potting media that you're going to be using for your keikis, generally you perhaps want a slightly more open mix than what you may initially want for your orchid. It's just to allow for those roots to acclimatize to less sunlight and slightly more moist conditions. And then you'll probably land up repotting this after a year or two anyway into a bigger pot as the keiki outgrows its pot. So you just want to ensure you have a good fast draining media with lots of aeration and some way to keep moisture around the plant in the air, such as a humidity dome, or evaporation trays also work well. And I think there I managed to squeeze both the repotting and the crucial aftercare into one section there. I hope you got that all. And remember, when removing and repotting these keikis, try and keep your orchid in a climate that suits the type of orchid that it is. And if you're unsure about that, please go check that Buy Me a Coffee link in the description box down below. Ed posts up a lot of content there all the time. That should be your go-to resource for all your orchid-related questions, and you'll be able to get ideas on which orchids prefer which sort of climates. And another little trick you can use to ensure rapid root growth on your little keikis is by using some vitamin B water. We'll drop the link to that video in the description box below. All you need to do is soak these in vitamin B water for about 5 minutes. That should be plenty, and it will help boost their root growth. And if you don't really want to use or can't find the correct vitamin B for them, as I suggest in the video, then try that ginger tonic that we use frequently. We'll also drop that video in the description box below. And happy propagating. Thank you for watching. If you find any of this information helpful, please hit that like button, hit that subscribe button, and that notification bell, bing bong, to be notified of all our upcoming content so you don't miss out on a thing. Help us grow as we help your orchids grow.